All right, we're in the section of Ephesians where the relationship between Jews and Gentiles in the church is dealt with. We're on page 6 of your handout on top with verse 12. Well, at the beginning of the coming together of Jews and Gentiles was not easy. Their relationship under the same roof was never really a comfortable one. But it should not be like this. While Paul in this section is laying out for us the two different routes both groups came from, he will also stress the fact that we are one family with the same Lord. Let's read again verse 12 of Ephesians 2, speaking to the Gentiles at Ephesus. Paul says that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. What he tells them is the following. First, originally the Gentiles were without Christ, meaning they had no national messianic hope until the church was created. Yeshua said in John 4:22, for salvation is of the Jews. Second, they were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, meaning they were outside Israel's divinely recognized commonwealth. Third, they were strangers from the covenant of the promise, meaning that God had entered into no covenant with them as he had with Israel. God did make the Edenic, Adamic, and Noahic covenant with the Gentiles. The nation of Israel is nowhere to be found before Genesis 12, where we can see her beginnings. The point is here that the four unconditional eternal covenants, the Abrahamic covenant, the land covenant, the Davidic covenant, and the new covenant were made with Israel exclusively. Fourth, they had no hope, meaning that no covenant promise had been accorded to them as far as the material and physical promise contained in the Jewish covenants. And fifth, the Gentiles were without God in the world, meaning they could not make no claim for his purpose or favor. What we learn then is that Christianity is essentially Jewish. And there is no possible way to divorce the Jews from the church. When the New Testament speaks of the relationship between Jews and Gentiles, a consistent terminology is used. We find words such as the one in Romans 11. They were grafted or brought near by the blood of Christ, as you have it in Ephesians 2:13. In Ephesians 2:12, we read that they were brought near the covenants and made part of the commonwealth of Israel. Ephesians, being at the heart of the New Testament, speaks loudly of its Jewish roots. And what actually was separating the Gentiles from coming to the fold? Ironically enough, it was that very thing that the Judaizers were trying to bring back to the commonwealth, then and today. See the following verses, verses 14 and 15. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace. What is the middle wall of partition? He says it in verse 15. It is the Mosaic law. One main purpose of the Mosaic law was to show the Jews that they could not follow the law, but that they were under the curse of the law until one would come and fulfill it. And this is precisely what Yeshua did. In coming, he freed us from the curse of the law, and now many, even today, are trying to bring it back, not realizing that the whole law pointed to him. You know, it's like a husband who leaves his wife for a long journey. And the wife kept a nice picture of the husband that she hanged on the wall. One day the husband comes back and she gets so excited, and the first thing she does, she takes the picture and she kisses it. Does that make sense? This wall surely reminded the reader of the time of the temple itself, where Gentiles actually were not allowed in. They were not allowed in the inner courts. There was an inscription archaeologists found in the temple compound. This is what it said. It said, no foreigner is to go beyond the balustrade and the plaza of the temple zone. Whoever is caught doing so will have himself to blame for his death, which will follow. The engraved block of limestone was discovered in Jerusalem in 1871. Its dimension is about 22 inches high by 33 inches long. Each letter was about 1.5 inch and originally painted in red ink against a white limestone. You have a picture of it up there. So the Roman actually permitted the Jewish authorities to carry out the death penalty for this offense, even if the offender was a Roman citizen. But now this was not there anymore. The curtain that separated the presence of God to the Jews was torn completely at the death of the Messiah. And the temple itself was destroyed, and the law was accomplished. So that now we are one in Yeshua. This is the point of Paul here. And this is the point that he makes, especially in verse 19, where it says, "Now therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. We are all members of the same house." While verse 19 speaks of the foundation of the new found home, the church, it was built by the apostle, that was built, that is, by the apostle and the prophets, with the Messiah himself being the chief cornerstone. Verses 20 and 21 confirms that this new union is the Lord's temple. See verse 20, 21. It said, "Having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstones, in whom the whole building being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord." Verse 22 confirms that God is exclusively found in the new temple, in the church of God. In verse 22, it confirms that God is exclusively found in there. It says, "In whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit." So see, notice that we have Jesus in verse 20, the Lord in verse 21, the Spirit in verse 22, the whole of the Trinity that is engaged in the church. More about the foundation of apostles and prophets later. And it is after all this that Paul is about to reveal yet another wonderful mystery concerning the congregation of God, the church of God. It is beginning with chapter 3 that Paul unravels this new mystery. We're beginning section 3 of your handout. Let's begin reading from verse 1 to verse 5. There are great things, by the way, in this section. It says, "For this reason I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if indeed you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which was written to me for you, how that by revelation he made known to me the mystery, as I have briefly written already, by which, when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to his holy apostles and prophets." And now verse 6, he reveals that mystery. He said that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ through the gospel. The mystery was that the church would be composed of Jews and Gentiles, united in one body. This is the mystery now being revealed. The point of this passage is that the universal church is composed of both now, Jews and Gentiles, who have believed in Yeshua. Now the mystery is not that the Gentiles should be saved. This was revealed already in the Old Testament, such as in Isaiah 42:6 or Zechariah 14:6. So it is not a mystery. In fact, it is at the core of the election of Israel. What the mystery says is that now both Jews and Gentiles are now on the same footing in Christ Jesus. In history, from Adam to Abraham, all were of Gentiles. This was a time of about 2,000 years. That, by the way, comes as a surprise to many Jews who thought that Adam was Jewish. This is what I thought before I believed in Yeshua. So when reading the history of Israel, some might think that if God went to the Gentiles, they would have done better. But he did go to the Gentiles. And they did not heed to the words of his prophets then. So he created Israel. Of those righteous Gentiles, we hear of Enoch, Methuselah, Noah, Job. And so from Abraham to Jesus, you have Jews and Gentiles together, a period of time of about 2,000 years. From Pentecost to now, you have another period of 2,000 years. And here you have the three groups, the Jews, the Gentiles, and the church together. Very much like what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10:32, where he divides the world into these three entities. He says, give no offense either to Jews, to the Gentiles, and to the church of God. By the way, if you count the years, you have 6,000 years, so we need 1,000 years to enter the millennium. At least this is what the rabbis believe. The seventh year, they believe, would be a Shabbat. 7,000 years would be a Shabbat year. By the way, this new body, this new creation, does not make a Jew into a Gentile, nor a Gentile into a Jew. It just makes us all, as we read in Ephesians 2:15, all one new man, where each one comes as he is and keeps his culture and history and grows into the Word of God. I love what it says in Galatians chapter 3:28 concerning this new man, this new entity. It says, there is neither Jew nor Gentiles. There is neither slave or free. There is neither male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. While we are all one, that doesn't mean that they do not each retain their identity in the same way that they are neither male or female. Imagine if we become no more male and female. This is tantamount to ask a Jew to forsake his culture and ancestry, or even to ask a Gentile to do the same. So we are united in our diversity. This is the beauty of the Church of God. And as we are all united in one belief, the entrance to this new formed body and the way to enter it has already been given to us back in Ephesians 2:8-9, an important verse we have not yet seen. You can go back there, Ephesians 2:8-9. It says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. First, we might ask what this passage is doing at the beginning of Ephesians 2. This, I believe, is linked to the demand of those Judaizers who were rebuilding again the wall of separation, which may amount to preaching salvation by works. Any return to the law lessens the strength of the grace that we find in the scriptures. Entrance to the kingdom of God is only by faith in Yeshua. It has always been a problem to explain this truth. People have a hard time when something is free and uncomplicated. But the Bible repeats it over and over. Since the beginning, it was always by faith through grace. You know, I read an illustration that spoke about an instant cake mix that was very successful but became a big flop. The instruction in the package said that all you had to do was to add water and bake it. And it worked wonders. But the company couldn't understand why it didn't sell, until their research discovered that the buying public felt uneasy about a mix that required only water. They found out that people need to buy it because it was too easy. That is, didn't want to buy it because it was too easy. So the company altered the formula and changed the direction to call for adding an egg and to mix in addition of putting water and mixing it well. The idea worked and the sales jumped dramatically. The people react in the same way when it comes to salvation. To them it sounds too easy and too simple to be true. Even though the Bible says, by grace you have been saved through faith, it is the gift of God, not of works. People cannot believe when it is that free. They need to do something. They feel that there is something more they must do, something they must add to God's recipe for salvation. And like the cake mix manufacturer, God has not changed his formula. Since the creation of man, to make salvation more marketable, he did not change it. So the gospel we proclaim must be free of works, even though it may sound too easy. And this point is that one thing, by the way, that separates biblical Christianity to all other religions. They all required some works, but you don't find it in the scriptures. This is the common denominator of the other religions. Remember the all-sufficient answer of Paul to the jailer in Acts 16:31. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and what happens? And you shall be saved. There's no requirement to understand the deep questions of theology or to perform impossible tasks. You cannot save yourself. Yeshua only will save you. And it is now that Paul pauses and praises. Considering the weight of this new revelation, we can understand that now he stops. We are on page 7, section B of your handout. The prayer is found in chapter 3, verses 14 to 21. And here he praises God and mentions again the three members of the Trinity. Before going to the prayer, let's consider the fact that Paul, let's consider the other prayer, where Paul formed this congregation at Ephesus, and knowing that he was not able to go there and be with these fairly new believers to oversee their growth and to protect them because he was confined away from them, he expressed two desires from them, and he had two requests, really, from them that we see in both prayers. The first one is found in the first prayer. Paul understood that a congregation that follows the precepts of God will be constantly under attack. He knew that within them there will always be some that will disturb the well-functioning of this newly formed body of the Messiah. He also knew that those believers carried with them that old self that may have been always ready to react at anything. In the first prayer, he prayed for their knowledge. It is in chapter 1, verses 16-23, where Paul prays that the eyes of their understanding may be enlightened, so that they may see what is the exceeding greatness of the power of God towards them. They needed to know these things. Paul knew that if they had the proper knowledge, the proper doctrines of God, they will be safe and well guarded, because the knowledge of the Word opens our mind to the thoughts of God. This was not a new concept, of course, in the Bible. The same desire Moses had voiced so many times to the congregation of Israel. David was completely overwhelmed by the power of the Word of God, as he shares it with us in the Psalm 119. Yeshua, our ultimate example, so beautifully demonstrates this truth in his temptation by responding only by quoting from the Word of God, showing us that knowledge of the Scriptures is a key that locks out those fiery darts of the evil one. But knowledge, as important as it is not enough. There is another element that needs to be added to it, otherwise it is worthless. What is the second element? This we find in the second prayer of Paul. The second very essential element is love. Love is the bond of unity between man and God and between man and his neighbor. In his prayer, Paul says that we should all be rooted and grounded in love. As he wrote in 1 Corinthians 13, you can have all the knowledge that is possible, okay, but if you have no love, you have really nothing. Love is not just another concept. Love is what? Love is God. Twice we are told in the letter of John that God is love, and the task of the believer is to grow in order to look more and more like God by putting on love and by loving more and more. This is Paul's argument in chapter 4, verse 24 of Ephesians, where he says, and that you put on the new man which is in the likeness of God, which is in the likeness of love. In chapter 5, verse 1, he says, therefore be imitators of God as beloved children. This is what is required of a believer. This is what was Paul's request to his new converts. They needed knowledge and they needed love. And from the exposition of this great element of love, Paul, in the remaining of this letter, expounds the way a believer in Yeshua should walk and should live. He is about to give us a portrait of one who professes faith in Jesus. And he is also about to give us the means to attain that goal. Here, he does not only speaks of the way believers should behave, but he even shows how a believer should speak. And he goes even to his own gestures, that is. The part of Ephesians we're about to study is truly a manual for Christian behavior. But again, behind the practical aspect, there lies again some great truth. Let's begin by reading the second prayer of Paul. This is found in chapter 3, verses 14 to 21. For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that we would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width, the length, the depth, and height, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. This is considered by many one of the most beautiful prayer we have in the scriptures. And there are some great truths that are contained in there. In both verse 14 and 15, we have a beautiful picture of a humble man full of love and very concerned for the sheep of God, who gets on his knees to bring his request to the Almighty. And we notice that the three members of the Trinity are here included. In verse 14, he mentions the Father, to whom the prayer is addressed. Then in verse 16, he mentions the Holy Spirit that lives in the inner man of each one of us. In Ephesians 1:13, he reminded us that we are sealed with him. Now he prays that this same Spirit strengthen us by his might or power. His prayer is that we realize the power that is available to us in him. And in verse 17, he mentions Yeshua, our Messiah, who also dwells in us through faith and who is knowable only through the Spirit. Reading of both the Messiah and the Holy Spirit, you come to the realization that they are both one and the same. All the members of the Trinity are the same, but distinct. Ephesians help us to address our prayers properly. And notice that in Ephesians chapter 1, 16 to 17, Paul addresses the prayer to whom? To the Father. He speaks to the Father of glory. Again, in Ephesians 3, 14, he states, I bow my knees unto the Father. Again, in Ephesians 5, 20, giving thanks always for all things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father. The clear teaching of the New Testament is that our prayers must be directed and addressed to God, the Father. Our greatest example of prayer life is from Yeshua himself. While Yeshua would not have addressed a prayer to himself, he could have addressed his prayer to the Holy Spirit. If so doing, if it was legitimate, that is. But he never addressed a prayer to the Holy Spirit. All his prayers were addressed to God the Father. There are six examples. The six examples, you can find them in John chapter 17. And it is here that Paul says something that is not easy to grasp. In verse 18 again, he prays that the Ephesians and ourselves may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width, the length, the depth, and height. What does Paul mean by this new geometrical figure having a width, a length, a depth, and a height? The difficulty is that we live and think in a three-dimensional way. But here Paul brings in a fourth dimension, and he's asking us to comprehend it. How can we? What can it be? What dimension is added here? There might be something here, it's a bit complicated, but it's worth looking at. There's another place in the scriptures where only three of these points are mentioned, that is in the description of heaven. Revelation 21:16 says, the city is laid out as a square, its length is as great as its width, and he measures the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs, its length, width, and height were equal. So here we are only given three points, the length, the width, and the height. And it is enough for us to understand the size and imagine a possible shape of the New Jerusalem. Most people think of a cube. But in Ephesians, you have an extra one, an extra dimension. What is it? And what could it represent? The dimension missing here is the depth, and the word missing, if you want, is the word bathos in the Greek. In Romans 11:32, this word is translated as unfathomable. His work in 1 Corinthians 2:12, there it is translated as the deep things of God. I asked, by the way, some of the scientists that we have in our congregation at Beit Ariel to help me understand that fourth dimension. I asked a mathematician, an engineer, and a physics professor. And first, what they all said is that in physics, when there's a fourth dimension, it's that of time. That I found very interesting. Could it be that in Ephesians, we're giving the same 3 points as the one in Revelation for heaven who exists in eternity, an extra one to describe perhaps the church of God that lives in time, and that is, in fact, said to be part of the kingdom of God? Could this added element be in reference to the church that lives in time? I don't want to make too much out of it, but the fact is that Paul is adding this extra dimension, and we ought to understand why. So our deduction may make sense, since Paul just spoke about this new revealed mystery concerning the church, an extension of the kingdom of God that is in heaven and to earth, and that lives in time. Off the record, I'm going to show you something which is believed to be a fourth dimension. As the small square is in the B square and it comes out. I love to think of this as the church, being in the world and out of the world at the same time. We'll come back to it after if you want. But all of these, by the way, all of these things that we just seen are a preparation of what comes next. Paul showed us the importance of the congregation of God and how connected it is to heaven. But before leaving this section, there are a few points we need to see. Paul shows that it is within the church that the riches of his glory are found and are made available to the believers, and it is within the congregation that the fullness of God, as you have it in verse 19, is declared to us. Again, verse 19 says, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. So to be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God is like filling the inside of a cup to its brim with water, let's say, from the ocean. The cup is filled with the ocean, but the ocean is not fully in the cup, since the full cup of water does not diminish the ocean. Yet the cup has the fullness of the ocean in the sense that it contains every ingredient that makes up the ocean. All the essential characteristics of the ocean are in the cup. And we notice again twice the word power is mentioned in this section. In verse 16, it says to be strengthened with might or power through his spirit in the inner man. And in verse 20, where he says, now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to what? The power that works in us. These are powerful words, by the way. We have here the word power here in verse 20 and 16 are the same Greek word, dunamis, where we get the word dynamite. And we are told that this is available in us. And verse 20, it says, now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all things or ask or even think. These blessings are available to us. And these are beyond what we may think. This is why every believer should believe that God can perform great miracles. God can perform great things in our life. We cannot even conceive in our mind what it says here, what he can do in our lives. If we believe that, and if we believe in prayer, then we can move on to this world and even change much of the world around us. Jesus says in Matthew 7:7, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you. So I'm going to believe that, and I'm going to ask that God shows us great miracles in our lives. Now we are about to look into the third part of our journey with Paul, being our tour guide. But this time he is much more than a tour guide, he is that zealous pastor who scolds and at the same time encourages his new converts. Let's now move on to section 4 of your handout, the walk of the believer in the Messiah. There Paul is about to say some things that you will not usually hear in a regular sermon. Many might even brand Paul as an extremist or a fanatic and a disturber of people's comfort. But beyond Paul, these are the words of God. And these powerful and descriptive words are not given to put down anybody, but to awake us all to the reality of the things in this world. This section of Ephesians represents a necessary part of the believer's knowledge, one that he will help him to make a marked distinction of the things of this world and the things of in the church. He had already begun his description of this world right at the beginning of chapter 2. Let's go back there again to see some of the characteristics that we haven't seen before. Chapter 2, verse 1. It speaks of us as we were and the world as it is now. It says that it's dead in trespasses and sins. In verse 2, we are told that we were under the prince of the power of the air, and he uses the terms of sons of disobedience for those under his claws. In verse 3, he adds this description of children of wrath. Hard to think this way of our unsaved neighbors. It doesn't seem to fit the bill, because some of my non-believing friends are so nice, and many of them seem to be living a good moral life, helping others. How can we think of them this way? While everybody is nice, and I truly think that many are really nice, what we read here is about another reality that we often miss. What we are giving here is a great revelation of the true condition of this world and of the people that live in it. Let's not be under the false impression. The truth is that they can be as nice as they could, but they could never be nice enough to buy their way to heaven. And they need to know that. And this is precisely why Jesus came to die. He resurrected. He did it for them all. God so loved the world. He loves the world. Every one of our neighbors he loves. But they ought to know about it. The force of this passage in front of us today help us to lift the veil and see beyond the appearances. And that truth is one of the first that Yeshua taught Paul. Remember the words of the Messiah when Paul was on the road to Damascus, when he called him to the ministry. We have seen this verse yesterday, and it's worth looking at it again. There Yeshua said to Paul that he chose him in order to go into the people of the world, to open their eyes in order to turn them from what? Two things, darkness and light. From the power of Satan to God. There's no middle ground. It's either one or the other. This is precisely what Paul is demonstrating here in Ephesians, between the church and between the world, faithful to the teaching of Yeshua. And here in chapter 4, Paul begins his discourse on the proper Christian walk, which is completely opposite from the one of our old walk. We are on page 8 of our handout, first titled The Characteristics of the Believer. Let's read verses 1 and 3 and notice all the words that he uses here. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. In verse 2, he gives a list of what characterizes a believer. A believer should be lowly, gentle, patient, and able to bear others in love, obviously. They must have had some people in there that were anything but that. And that is cause of a split in a church. This is why he right away links it with the unity of the congregation. He encourages them in verse 3 to endeavor, that is to try hard, to make haste, to keep the unity in peace. Unity, love, peace. This is what characterizes a church of God that is striving to keep their sanctification going on a daily basis. You know, there's a legend about a man who had arrived in heaven, and he told the angels there how grateful he was to be in such a gracious and glorious place. So he asked one of them if he could have one glimpse into Hades in order that he might appreciate the good fortune even more. So the angel said, fine, and he brought him right down there. In Hades, he saw a long table extending as far as the eye could reach, laden down with the most delicious of all varieties of food, but everyone around the table was starving to death. When asked for an explanation, the angel said, well, everyone is required to take food from the table only with a 4-foot-long chopsticks. They are so long that no one can reach the food from the table to his mouth, and therefore each one is dying of starvation. Quickly, they returned to heaven, and behold, the men also saw an identical table, laden with down with identical food, but everyone around the table was happy, and they were well fed. But he asked the angel, with what do they take the food from this table? And the angel answered, only with a 4-foot-long chopsticks. At that, the new arrival inquired, then why are all those in Hades starving to death while all those up here are so well fed and happy? The angel replied, in heaven we feed each other. This is the way it should be in any congregation of God. We ought to support each other and feed each other and not speak or do harm to each other. We ought to love each other. And this is a theme, by the way, that is across the gospel up to the end of the law of Christ. And it is here that Paul speaks of the importance of the unity of the body of the Messiah. See Ephesians 4, verses 4 to 6. It says, there is one body and one spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Now, even with this, we still have 350 different denominations in Christianity. Notice that there are only 7 elements here. One body, one spirit, one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and one God. Again, we see the number 7, which shows a completeness. We can see this, by the way, through a menorah. Here we can also see the 3 members of the Trinity, the Spirit, the Lord, and God. You can see that in the screen. In the middle, you have the Lord. On the right, you have the Messiah who dwells in our heart through faith, and is through baptism that we identify with him. On the left, you have the Spirit of God who is in the body of the Messiah and who indwells in us and sanctifies us and gives us the hope we need. That is the 7 components of the church. So we can see here that the church of God is one body with the Messiah, and we are one body together. Our relationship is much stronger than it appears. We are more than friends here. And we are one in that we have one hope, the blessed hope, that is the conviction that Yeshua can come even tonight, and the conviction that we will spend eternity with him. This hope tells us that we will be with him forever and ever. We are all one in that we have one faith. We have the same faith. That is a strong tie. Since faith is the one that leads us to the Messiah Yeshua, it is that one single way to him. And finally, we are one in that we have one baptism. That is, we are all in that identified with the same Lord. And what Paul is saying is, make haste. Make sure that you work in the congregation to keep the unity of the congregation. By the way, it will never break anyway, because it belongs to God. See how he ends in verse 6. One God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. 4 times he repeats the word all. God is the Father of all, above all and through all. This word through is used as a channel. God works through the members of the body. God works through the church in order to produce fruits on this earth. Many people come to the congregation and they say, well, I can make it by myself. No, you cannot make it by yourself. God has decreed that we are a body with different gifts. You know, I don't know if you've seen an ear walking by itself or an eye. So we are all, we compose the body of the Messiah. And so that really speaks of the unity of the body of the Messiah. Do not think that Paul could have used a better construction of words and illustration to bring to us the importance of the unity of the congregation and the need to love each other. However, some might ask, in fact, some do ask, how can I love this one or that one? See what they did to me. Just want to give you another illustration. This is a strong one. You know, I read a true story about the practice of love. Newspaper columnist and minister George Crane tells of a wife who came into his office full of hatred toward her husband. "I do not only want to get rid of him, I want to get even before I divorce him. I want to hurt him as much as I can." So Mr. Crane suggested an ingenious plan. He says, "Go home and act as if you really love your husband. Tell him how much he means to you. Praise him for every decent trait. Go out of your way to be as kind, considerate, generous as possible. Spare no effort to please him, to enjoy him. Make him believe that you love him. After that he's convinced, then you drop the bomb. Tell him that you want a divorce. You're going to hurt him so well." So with revenge in her eyes, she smiled and exclaimed, "Beautiful, beautiful. Will he ever be surprised?" And she did it with enthusiasm, acting as if. For 2 months, she showed love, kindness, listening, giving, reinforcing, and sharing. When she didn't return, Crane called, and he said to her, "Are you ready now to go through the divorce?" The woman realized that she, in fact, did love her husband. The fact of practicing love brought her to be delivered from the hatred that filled her heart. Love comes through practice. C.S. Lewis explained well this truth in his book, Mere Christianity. This is what he wrote. He says, "Do not waste your time bothering whether you love your neighbor. Act as if you did. As soon as we do this, we find one of the greatest secrets. When you are behaving as you love someone, you will presently come to love them." He's right on. Let's practice love towards the others. We may not find it on the spot right away, but it will come. And while there is unity, there's again diversity. It is in the next verse that he begins to show that there is diversity within this great unity. He says in verse 7, "But to each one of us, grace is given according to the measure of Christ's gift." Each believer is an important element again in this body. No believer is useless, and no believer is here just an extra pawn in the body. If you find yourself useless, it is surely that you have not yet used the great power that the Spirit of God has given you. Each and every believer is unique and can make a big difference in the congregation, in the church where he is or she is. So it is important that we all know our gifts, because God has given to each one of us gifts so we can function better in our congregation. Does everyone know their gifts here? We are developing a test to know one's gift. It'll be ready in about 2 or 3 months. You can always email us, ralcanada.com. You can go in the site and it will be listed there. I encourage you to take that test. It will give you an indication to how you can work in your own church. I would like to conclude with attempting to define a healthy church. What are the elements to look for in a church to see if its lampstands are still lit? What are we to look for? And this is applicable, by the way, to one's personal evaluation as well. There are 7 things that are important. This is according to a survey done through hundreds of pastors. The first one is Bible knowledge. When the congregation members are increasing in their grasp of the teaching of the Bible, it means they are growing. That is the core of a growing church. If there is no strong biblical teaching, the church may not grow and produce fruit. It may be big, it might be entertaining, but not in the biblical way. The first thing we ask when we get into a church is their statement of faith. If it is too short, you have to ask the questions. The second one is personal devotions. What are the members doing with the teaching they receive? If they spend time daily in prayer, in Bible reading, in meditation, and other personal spiritual exercises, it means that the congregation is growing. Let's not be shy to ask. You know, in for the elders, the requirements of the elders in 1 Timothy chapter 3, the elders really are the pastor of a church, becomes a public person. His house is open for anyone to go in and to see how he behaves. This is the requirement, and we may ask the pastor about their personal lives. Third is the worship. Worship is much more important than what many think. Worship has a big place in the Bible. If the members regularly participate in the worship services scheduled by the congregation and participate and do not regularly show up in the middle of worship, then according to these hundreds of pastors, it's an indication of the growth of the church. Worship is an important part of the congregation. Fourth is witnessing, evangelism. Members of a strong and growing church regularly attempt to share their faith in Yeshua with unbelievers. The congregation will also put a great emphasis on evangelism. Fifth is giving. This is a sign of commitment. It doesn't matter how much you give, but when one ought to give for the work of the Lord. Fellowship. Members are growing in their personal relationship with each other through regular participation in the congregation fellowships group of one kind or another. We need each other. We need to be together and to speak to it together because we're brothers and sisters. We're going to spend eternity together. And seventh, a distinct lifestyle. Members generally manifest their faith in the Messiah by living a lifestyle clearly and noticeably distinct than the non-Christian in the same community. You know, there was a survey done last year in the Christianity Today, and it was they asked 900 ex-Muslims that came to believe, and they asked them, what is that thing that brought you to believe? Two things, actually. The first one, they said, was Christian behavior. Even in Saudi Arabia and all these countries, you have some Christians. They were looking at them and they were seeing how they were walking. That was the first thing. You know what was the second thing? That's very interesting, by the way. No, actually, it was dreams and visions. And I believe that. I'm not Pentecostal, but I believe that when the Bible cannot enter a certain territory, God will use some extraordinary means to bring these people to a saving knowledge. Okay? So we are at page 8 of your handout, directly at the bottom of the page, the section on Ephesians 4, 11 to 14. It is here that are listed some important gifts of the Spirit, those that pertain to those who bring the Word of God. Let's read from your Bible, Ephesians 4, verses 11 to 14. And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors, teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. And so we see here four gifts. The first and important one is the gift of apostleship. This was a unique gift because in order to receive this gift, one had to meet certain qualifications beyond that of being a believer. While all believers were eligible for any other gift, only certain believers were eligible for the gift of apostleship. And we can see in the New Testament two groups of apostles. In the first circle is composed of 12 apostles. To qualify for this group, one had to have been a follower of Yeshua from the baptism of John. He was first to have been a disciple of John the Baptist, then to have followed Jesus, and to have seen the resurrected Messiah and his ascension. This is understood in the section of Matthias, to replace Judas Iscariot in Acts 1:22. It says, beginning from the baptism of John until the day that he was received up from us, of this must one become a witness with us of his resurrection. But there was a second group of apostles, and the requirement for this group was to have seen the resurrected Messiah. Paul, who had never undergone John's baptism, fulfilled this requirement. For he saw the resurrected Messiah on the road to Damascus. On this basis, he defends his apostleship in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 1, where Paul says, am I not free? Am I not an apostle? Have I not seen Jesus our Lord? And you not my work in the Lord? So Paul proved his apostolic calling by claiming that he had seen the resurrected Messiah. Paul calls himself an apostle, and in most that is of his letters, especially the beginning of the letter of Ephesians. Barnabas also was also an apostle of the second circle, according to Acts 14:14. James, the half-brother of Jesus, was an apostle of the second circle as well, according to 1 Corinthians 15:7. James had seen the resurrected Messiah, and Galatians 1:19 puts him in the category of an apostle. So only those who saw the resurrected Messiah ever qualified for receiving this particular gift. Therefore, this gift was only available to the 500 people of 1 Corinthians 15:6 who saw the resurrected Messiah, and not everyone, of course, of those received the gift of apostleship. And the particularity of this gift always included the power of miracles, which was the evidence of his apostleship. This we can conclude from 2 Corinthians 2, that is 12:12, where we read, truly the signs of an apostle were made among you in all patience by signs and wonders and mighty works. So Paul proved himself to be an apostle in both ways. First, he had seen the resurrected Messiah on the road to Damascus. Second, he had the power of an apostle as proven by his many miracles, signs and wonders. So this gift was a very desired gift, especially by false teachers. Later, this church of Ephesus had the visits of false apostles, but these knew how to recognize them. This we can see in Revelation 2:2, the letter of Jesus to the church of Ephesus. There we read, I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil, and you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars. So some people came to them and pretended to have that special revelation from God. But these did not believe them, but they tested them and found them to be liars. In order to test these false apostles, they needed to have a very strong hold of their doctrines. And in fact, the church of Ephesus was well trained. They had Paul, and then they had Timothy, and also they had John the Apostle that was with them. And notice who these people pretended to be, the highest one in the church, the apostles. They did not pretend to be elders or pastors, because elders and pastors are subjected to the church. They're subjected to the board. But apostles were those who were directly working under God. So they would come and say, God told me, so listen to me. The moment one says he is an apostle, he pretends to speak directly from God, just like the modern day prophets or false prophets. The same problem Moses faced when many came and pretended to prophesy speaking in the name of God. God in the Old Testament had no tolerance for this. And it seems that many wanted to be apostles, since this title carried much power. And this remained a major problem even after Paul and after Timothy and after John. In the Didache, which is the oldest handbook of doctrine and Christian living of the early believers, This was written in the second century. This book has much to say about false apostles. Let me read to you an excerpt. This is what it says. It says, "Welcome every apostle on arriving, as if he were the Lord, but he must not stay beyond one day. In case of necessity, however, the next day too. If he stays 3 days, he is a false prophet. On departing, an apostle must not accept anything save sufficient food to carry him till the next day lodging. If he asks for money, he is a false prophet." They must have had a lot of problems with these people, you know. It's interesting that everyone wants to have the first place. You know, I also recently read that in Israel, the religious affairs ministry told reporters that their office had received numerous complaints from institutions in Israel and abroad about men who have crowned themselves rabbis. They said Israel has no supervision over the title of rabbis, and anyone can have his own rabbi stationery printed. It seems that everyone wants to be a rabbi today also because of the fame and the power attached to it. Same as in Revelation 2:2. The other gift is that of prophecy. The gift of prophecy was the ability to receive direct revelation. A prophet was one who received direct revelation from God. There are several examples of this in the New Testament. You have the prophet in the church of Antioch in Acts 13:1. In Acts 11 and 21, we read of Agabus. And we know of the daughters of Philip in Acts 21. But today I want to tell you we have the written word of God and need no more extra information. There are today many who take the liberty to prophesy. And the sad thing is that they make mistakes after mistakes, and it seems to bother no one. People are enamored about anything when it comes to their own personal future. Now, did not Moses say that a prophet, if a true prophet, that is a true prophet, should give prophecies that are 100% accurate? This is in Deuteronomy 18:22. And I want to tell you, I'm amazed of how many prophets we have in different churches and how many emails we get of prophets who say that they have certain prophecies. Like the last time somebody called, he says he has a prophecy for Montreal, and I said, you better not give it to me, because if it doesn't happen, I'll have to put you out of the church. Deuteronomy 18:22 says, when a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the thing does not happen or come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord has not spoken. The prophets have spoken it presumptuously. You shall not be afraid of him. Not be afraid in the Hebrew really means not to have fellowship with him. This person should be put out of the congregation. Once they come and speak a prophecy, what they are really doing is to pretend deity, really. They present themselves as gods. The words of God are complete and frozen in the scriptures. We know all that we need to know until Jesus comes back. Nothing is lacking. Like these false prophets, many of these are coming in our congregations, but these need to be checked. Once again, they pretend to speak from God, and as such, they come under 1 Timothy 3. They are required in a way to produce a curriculum vitae, and where we are to see if they fit the bill. Usually these people have a dubious life. The next gift is the gift of evangelism. The gift of evangelism is a unique God-given ability to win people to the Messiah. But this gift is given at different degrees to all, since we all are called to evangelize. For instance, 2 Timothy 4:5, Timothy did not have the gift of evangelism, but he had the gift of teaching. So he became a teacher elder in the church of Ephesus. When Paul wrote to Timothy, he told him to do the work of an evangelist. Although Timothy could not be an evangelist because he did not have the gift, he could at least do the work of one, and that is to witness and to bring the word to others. Every believer has the responsibility of doing the work of an evangelist. Every believer is responsible to witness concerning the truth about the gospel. In fact, what is that one thing that we cannot do in heaven that we do on earth? to evangelize, because there are no sinners in heaven. This is one major reason why we are here on earth. The Bible says that our citizenship is in heaven, that our house is in heaven, really. As soon as we accept the Lord, we should go. But we're still here, and one of the main reasons is to evangelize. The other gift is that of pastor-teacher. Some translations read pastor and teacher, but the word "and" is not in the Greek text. A proper translation of this should be pastor-teacher. The gift of teaching is the ability to organize the truth and to present it. Not everyone who has the gift of teaching will necessarily have the gift of pastoring. But everyone who has the gift of pastoring will and should automatically have the gift of teaching, because the two go together. What is the role of a pastor? It involves shepherding. Shepherding involves guiding the flock, leading the flock, and feeding the flock with the word of God. If someone is guiding, leading, and feeding the flock, he's doing the work of pastoring. But he will only be able to do so by being able to teach properly the doctrines found in the scriptures. All of the gifts Paul mentions here pertain to the teaching and proclamation of the word. This could be well illustrated by a jigsaw puzzle, if you want. All the parts of the puzzle are equal. That is, they are of equal importance to the completed puzzle. And without all of the parts, the puzzle will be incomplete. However, when building the puzzle, one looks first for the four corner pieces that are foundational to the completion of the rest of the puzzle. So too, the four gifts mentioned in Ephesians 4 are foundational to the completion of the mature body of Christ. When the jigsaw is finished, the four corner pieces are no more value than the rest of the others. Even though they bring in the word of God, we're all equal in the body of the Messiah. And I read somewhere that some have recognized that there are four main bones to every church. You have the wish bones, those who are wishing somebody will do something about the problem, and in the meantime they do not move much. You have the jawbone. You know what is that for? Those who do all the talking and do very little else. You have the knuckle bones. Those actually who push everybody else and complain about everything. But you have the backbones, right? Those who carry the brunt of the load and do most of the work. It's sad, but it's always like this in a church. Let's now go to page 9 of your handout, section B. Previously, Paul mentioned the presence of the evil one and gave us a description of the condition of the unsaved. It is in Ephesians 4:17 that he comes back to the charge. He now compares the believers to the unbelievers, and he does not spare his words here. See, beginning of verse 17, let's read verse 17 to verse 19. Says, "This I say therefore and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in the futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God, because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart, who being past feeling have given themselves over to lewdness, to work all uncleanness and greediness." You know, with such a description, it's no wonder that Paul made himself many enemies. And we see it especially in 2 Corinthians. Even today, many do not like him because he speaks these words so strongly. But so did the Old Testament prophets. And most of them were killed because of these things. And what these great men of God had in common is summed up in what Paul says. One thing we ought to imitate. This we find in 1 Corinthians 2:2, when he says, "For I determined to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." This is such, I want to tell you, a powerful verse. If we make this our motto and put it in front of our walk, we will produce much, much more. And we see in this man, Paul, the same resentment to sin and such a godly jealousy for what is pure, what is holy. Something we find in all these men of God, especially in our Messiah in the Gospels. So Paul here first, he speaks of the futility of their mind. The word futility designates what is devoid of truth. And what truth is that, by the way? The truth about God. Men in general can be very smart, they can be very clever. They may come up with great invention and beautiful philosophical deductions, but as far as the true reality of God, this is nothing. Because we learn again in 1 Corinthians 3:19 that the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. Without the Spirit of God and without Yeshua, ultimately man's mind will lead him nowhere. And as a consequence, we learn in verse 18 that they are alienated from the life of God. Every man is until he finds Yeshua. This is the simple teaching of the scriptures. And furthermore, we are told in verse 18 that they are blinded in their hearts. And this is not derogatory at all. It is the reality. And the truth is that it is only when we come to realize this, it is then where we can truly love the people of this world and minister to them. Otherwise, we might live thinking they are okay, but they're not okay. You cannot offer healing to people whom you think they are well. If you realize their condition, as Paul brings it out here, then you can help them. And who better than you who now knows about these things? I believe this is Paul's point here. He was not putting down people. He is one of the greatest evangelists that ever lived. And what he says here is necessary for evangelism. And there is always that urgency that we find in all the scriptures, especially with Paul. Everything is urgent. Look at Ephesians 5:16, where Paul says, redeeming the time because the days are evil. That is also the reality of things. The problem is, we believers can live and not realize any of these things. Until one day we wake up face to face with Yeshua, the Bema seat of Christ. What do you think he's going to ask us? What have you done with everything that I've given you? A driver stopped his car at an intersection and waited for the green signal. When the green light came, he waited further to confirm it. He wasn't too sure. That is, he waited until the light turned green a second time. After that, he waited till further until the light flashed a third time because he wasn't too sure, you know. It's absurd, okay? No one would drive like that, okay? But are there not believers who live like that driver drove? They are so overcautious that they wait for signs from God, wait to reconfirm the signs, and then wait for a moment, the moment to act. They are waiting almost perpetually and can never redeem the time they wasted or the opportunity they lost. And so we ought to redeem the time, as Paul says, in haste. And so it is after enumerating all the attributes of this fallen world that now Paul turns to the congregation of Ephesus and pronounces these strong words. Verse 20, look at of Ephesians 4. He says, but you have not so learned Christ. Some of them were probably still living like the rest of the people of Ephesus with the wonderful and corrupt temple of Diana in their midst. They were living in the blindness of their heart. But this is not how they have learned Christ. And the following verse is even more powerful. He even goes further and here. Of those who comfortably live in sin without being disturbed, I believe here he turns to them, to the tares of the church, who began to be comfortable in the church. And he says in verse 21, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus. The possibility of non-believers in their midst is truly now something that is sure. In fact, Jesus told us in the parable of the kingdom in Matthew 13 that the wheat will become smaller and smaller and the tares will become bigger and bigger. If this verse makes you doubt your salvation, then it is not for you. The last thing Paul wants is for us to doubt our salvation. It's really meant for us to realize that we live in a world that rejects God, and also to realize that in our midst there may be some unbeliever. So we have to know these things and act accordingly. Again, you probably heard of the water spider, which is an amazing little creature. You know, it lives in rivers and streams, but how does this fascinating species survive in this watery environment is really amazing. You know what it does? It spins a tough basket-like web of silk, a kind of diving bell, and anchors it under water to plants and other objects. Then it captures a surface air bubble, which it pulls down and ejects into its underwater house, filling it with air. This combination of web building and bubble trapping allows the water spider to live in an environment that normally will destroy it. This is a great image of the believer living in this world. As believer, we too live in an environment that could destroy us. The world's values, attitudes, and practices threatens to drown us unless we are able to protect ourselves from them. How are we to survive spiritually in this hostile worldly environment? We must build a bubble of protection around ourselves by studying the scriptures, by praying, fellowshipping with believers. These activities would insulate our minds and help us safe and secure. And to drive his message even further, see what he adds. Let's go to Ephesians 5:5. For this you know that no fornicator, unclean person, no covetous man who is an idolater has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. This is again powerful. Paul points here is don't do these things, because this is the mark of those who are not going to heaven. It is possible that many in the church still live in sin. This prompted Paul to speak like this. What a man this Paul must have been. He is not concerned about losing members in the church, because if we come up with such sermons, the church will empty itself. He is not concerned about the expenses or a mortgage, because if these people leave, they might not make ends meet. But Paul knew to put the sanctity of the congregation first. He had complete faith in God. And the list of things to do is found from verse 25 to 32 of Ephesians 4. Let's go back to Ephesians 4, which constitute a good part of the law of Christ. Let's read from verse 25. It says, therefore, putting away lying, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearer. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God in Christ forgave you. And so there we find lying, stealing, bad words flying around, bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking, malice. They must have had some serious problems in this church. But let's not go too fast, because these things are not that uncommon in the life of a believer. Now, concerning the tongue, about lying and about those words we use sometimes without thinking, this must have been one big problem, because Paul deals with it in four different parts of his discourse. First, in Ephesians 4:25, therefore, putting away lying, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Again, in verse 29, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth. Then we read in Ephesians 5:3, but fornicators and all uncleanness or covetousness, let not even be named among you. Here he deals about some gossiping and bad subject that slipped into the conversation of believers. And to this, Paul adds in 5:12, for it is shameful even to speak of those things which are done by them in secret. Now concerning lying, swearing, and gossiping, all of these things are not to be found in the believer's life. That's the law of Christ. Concerning lying, the Greek word is pseudo, where we get our word pseudonym, which means a false name. We know the people mainly by the words they speak, because we cannot know the heart of men. And if they lie, they are portraying somebody else and bearing a false name. That's the idea. And what shall we say and how shall we talk to each other? Paul tells us. Here the Spirit does not leave us to guess. He even teaches us what we should say to each other. Ephesians 5, 19 to 20. Speaking to one another in psalms, in hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is what we ought to do, what we ought to speak when we are together. Speak of what you have read in the scriptures this morning. Speak of a psalm, sing together, sing in your heart as well. And we ought to always give thanks to God the Father through our Lord Jesus Christ himself. Being in communion with believers should be like being in an island of edification and comforting words, always uplifting God. This is what the church of God should be. And back in verse 26 of Ephesians 4, there's another quotation from the Old Testament. There it says, be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath. This is taken from Psalm 4:4, which reads, be angry and do not sin. Meditate within your heart, on your bed, and be still. Psalm 4 is a beautiful short psalm. David speaks of those who belong to the Lord. What he says is so fitting in the context of Ephesians. Here David speaks of the remnant of Israel, and what he says can be applied to the newly formed body of the Messiah. This is why Paul brings this to his epistle. See what David says in verse 3 of Psalm 4. I want to tell you, you can take that verse here and put it in the book of Ephesians. Nobody would notice. He says, but know that the Lord has set apart for himself him who is godly. The Lord will hear when I call to him. And when it comes to anger, when you are angry against your brother or sister, against your husband or wife, the scriptures commands us not to sleep until you resolve that anger. That is, again, a commandment of the Lord. In itself, anger is not necessarily a sin, because even God can be angry. Jesus was angry against the sellers in the temple. But this is holy anger. It is anger that stems from holiness and love and seeing the injustice of evil. If we experience this anger, it is a manageable anger. It is reasonable anger. However, when anger is unmanageable, it is uncontrollable. It is then not based on righteousness, then it is evil. There's a marked difference between hating evil and feeling anger based on pride. You know, a newspaper once reported, and this is true, on a couple in England who had lived together as silent partners for 12 years. The wife was finally seeking a divorce. For 12 extraordinary years, they had lived their lives so that they wouldn't have to meet each other. According to their lawyer, Simon King, who was handling the case, when one would come in the house, the other would leave. And when they did communicate with each other, it was through notes. They had lived happily together for the first 18 years of their marriage and had raised a son. For the last 12 years, however, they didn't speak to each other. Ironically, neither one could remember what the hassle had been all about. You know, this is how long anger can last, and even longer. It could paralyze you for a very long time. And this is why the command is to forgive before the sun goes down. In both their minds of these people, they have transformed their partners as a monster. This is what happens when you do not resolve an issue with someone else. That person will gradually become an ogre. And this is serious. Because Jesus says that this is where the seed of murder begins. If you remember what he says in Matthew 5, verse 21, he says, "You have heard what it was said of those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be in danger of judgment. But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment." At least this is how murderers begin their rationalization that a person is fit to die. It starts with a little bit of anger. And that shouldn't be found, Paul says, in the mind of the believers. So far Paul has dealt with the problem of the tongue, then that of anger. There's another problem that seems to invade the lives of many believers. See how bold he is in verse 28. 4:28. "Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need." Well, we are not thieves, as the world understands stealing today. But this sin is much more subtle than that. We can define stealing by saying that it is to take something without right or permission, that which belongs to another. And there are many things that fall into this category. Not only material things, such as you have other things such as time, ideas, and even withholding wages, withholding payments or debts that we owe, even to somebody or maybe to the government. All these things might fall into this category. Even taking office supplies for personal use, or using the copier for personal use without telling the owner, it might fall, and I think it falls into this category. These might appear petty, but I believe are important in the eyes of God. In fact, it seems that these things will determine how much God will allow you to work for Him. We remember what our Lord said in Luke 16:10. "He who is faithful in what is least is faithful in much." So it starts at the lower level. That is logical and very true. God looks at the very small thing in our lives, and from there will decide how much to give us in the ministry. The conclusion of this portion is seen in the last verse of chapter 4 and the first verse of chapter 5. It says, "And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God in Christ forgave you. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear children. And God forgave us, as God forgave us in Yeshua, so we ought to forgive, we ought to love, we have to be kind to our brothers." This is the message. And it is not only normal that we do that, and that we imitate God. And what should be our attitude towards those who find pleasure in evil? We are told of two things. We are now at the bottom of page 9 of your handout, the title before last. First, let's see chapter 5, verse 7. It says, "Therefore, do not be partakers with them." That does not mean that we should not have friends who are not believers. But it surely means that you cannot have friends who are unruly and who overtly live in sin. What will happen is that they will eventually influence you, and you will become like them. The second passage is, as far as our attitude towards them, is in verse 11. It says, "And have no fellowship with unfruitful work of darkness, but rather expose them." Now there's something in there. Here we are told one more time not to have fellowship with them. The second verse speaks of those who are within the church and live freely in sin. These, Paul says, have no fellowship with them. And second, he commands us to expose them, to denounce them. We are not to denounce the people who live outside the congregation, but those that are inside are influencing the other to live in sin. The best gift you can give these believers, these people, is to expose them to the leadership. If they are believers, they need to get back on track, and it is the role of the leadership again to work this with much love. If we don't expose them, then the law says we partake with them. Not easy at all. But what we have here is the description of a biblically based church. A true church is one that is described in the Bible. It would be one with all these qualities and restrictions that we find in Ephesians. And we learn from Ephesians 5:18 that the believers, as opposed to those in the world, are filled with the Spirit. That's important. He says, and do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. To be filled means to be controlled, just as someone who is filled with alcohol is controlled by alcohol. This is the point of Paul here. In order to allow the Spirit to control our lives in daily living, there must be the initial act of dedication of our lives to God. These conditions involve yieldness and obedience to the Word of God. How can you know that you are living a Spirit-filled life? You have a few results listed that is on your handout, top of page 10. But let me ask you two questions that will help you see if actually you walk in the Spirit. And these are very simple questions. First, have you made the initial dedication as it is asked by the Lord in Romans 12:1? He says, where Paul says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is a reasonable service. He says, please do it. You know why? Because it's our choice. We are saved, yes, we are eternal salvation. And here Paul, as he begins the law of Christ, right in this chapter, he says, please, follow it. And so if the answer is yes, the second, as far as you know, are you yielding in every area in your lives? I don't know if you remember about the kings of Israel. Even the best kings, they did well, but at the end he says, but they left some things. They left some things in the, some idols in Israel and so on and so forth, okay? Even the best of them have left some things. So there's always areas in our lives we can go and clean out. And it is here where we come to an important passage of the scriptures where two very dear institutions of God are here presented to us in a most beautiful way. These institutions are the marriage and the church. Yeshua had already stamped the institution of marriage and showed us its great importance by performing the first miracle, his first miracle, by stamping his ministry at a wedding feast in Cana. He could have gone to the temple or chosen a place where sin abounded to perform that first miracle. He could have turned the sky red. He could have blown all the trumpets in Israel to announce his arrival, but he chose to go to a marriage where only a few people witnessed and perhaps understood his first coming. And now that Jesus left this earth, the Spirit of God here in this epistle furthers and completes for us this great link by weaving these two institutions of the marriage and the church. And one of the most amazing things in the relation of the marriage and the church is that in both institutions, the parties become one. In the earthly marriage, the wife and the husband become one flesh. Concerning the congregation of God, the believer, in some mysterious ways, becomes one with the Messiah. So much so that in the epistles, the scriptures now calls that this new union between God and his convert, the body of the Messiah. By entering the body of the Messiah, the believer does not become a God, nor does he become a Christ when he accepts Yeshua as his personal Savior, but he joins and becomes part of the body of the Messiah. This, by the way, is very hard to understand. And that even baffled Paul, who after making this comparison of these two institutions says in Ephesians 5:32, this is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. A mystery it is, but it's also a great truth we ought to take hold of as it speaks of an eternal union with God, something that will never ever be broken, and that begins right here on earth. And Paul, practical as he always is, takes hold of these two divine institutions here in Ephesians and brings out their practical aspects. He tells us what should be the natural consequences of their existence in our everyday life. And again, it does not go easy. The words found in our text brought many to brand him as a male chauvinist, as an anti-feminist person. But all these accusations are unfounded. On the contrary, what we are about to learn from Paul has a liberating effect. Just as Jesus said about all the words contained in the scriptures, his words will set us free. So how does Paul begin his expose? Let's go directly to Ephesians 5:22. Abruptly, he says, "Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is head of the church, and he is the savior of the body." With a sudden abruptness again, Paul mentions the closest practical relationship in life, marriage, and there brings our two problems often found in marriages. Subjection of the wives toward their husbands, that's the first one. And on the other side, the second one, is lack of love of the husband towards the wife. Let's read the following verse before we go further. Let's read verse 24 and 27 to 27. It says, "Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such things, but that she should be holy and without blemish." In verse 22, the wife is encouraged to be in subjection to her husband, and she is in subjection to the Lord. One will definitely reflect the other. And later in verse 24, it is repeated that as the church is subject to the Messiah, so the wife should be subjected to her husband in everything. To the husband in verse 23, he is told that he is the head of the wife as the Messiah is the head of the church. And later in verse 25, the husband ought to love his wife as the Messiah loves his church to the point of giving his life for her. First, let's look at what is that one thing he brings out right in front, submission. Whether it is submission of the wife to her husband or that of the believer to God, see how Paul brings out this unpopular point and see how he attributes its necessity to different areas of life. Within the church, everyone must be submitted to another. Look what he says in verse 21, submitting to one another in the fear of the Lord. The problem of submission takes a big part in this epistle. And he does not stop with the wives. In 6:1, he speaks of the children. "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." In verse 5, chapter 6, he also involves the workplace. See what he says. "Servant, obey your employers loyally with a proper sense of respect and responsibility." Considering this insistence, submission then must be a very important aspect of our walk on earth. And it's true that this word can be a very repulsive and revolting for many. Let me read to you what the Webster Dictionary gives us as synonyms and related words for submission. This translates well how people understand this word. These are the words: surrender, capitulation, bowing, compliance, resignation, prostration. With this understanding of submission, I understand that women do not want to submit to their husband, especially those who know the word and have understood the fairness of the laws of God. I understand why employees resent their employers and why unions are so powerful. And we can understand why children may resent their parents. But this is not what biblical submission is. It is very different. There is, in fact, something great to grasp in the biblical definition of submission. So we need to redefine the word, because God will not bring us back, he will not bring his people back from where he saved them. Let me give you one word that is related to and will help us define the biblical submission: freedom. Freedom from carrying the world on your shoulder and making all the decisions yourself. It is freedom from being paralyzed under the weight of the demands that this world puts on us, and to share the loads with others. It is freedom to do what you do best and allow the others to do the rest. Submission. It is the great privilege of knowing God's sovereignty and understanding that He has appointed different people at different level for different tasks. This is what submission implies, and it will lead us to true freedom and personal development. It is true freedom because submission brings order. It brings autonomy and self-determination. This might appear to be so contrary to what we understand this word to mean, but this is the outcome of submission in the scriptures. The Greek word for submission in the New Testament is composed of two words, under and to appoint, under and to ordain, meaning that you put yourself under one who has been appointed because you cannot do all things. Submission is the intelligent way to put yourself under one who has been appointed leader for that particular situation because he will do the work better. It is the same with biblical submission. It is for the best of your spiritual health as God works with men he appointed at different level of the ministry here on earth. And submission, and this is important, is the mark of those whom God can work with. No one could willingly be under God's authority who has not already submitted to some higher authority here on earth. Whether it be in the scriptures or in the history of Christianity, and the more the submission, the stronger and more independent these men and women of God were. Before we leave the subject of submission of the wife to her husband, Peter adds a further dimension to it. See what he says in 1 Peter 3:1. It says, "Wives, likewise be submissive to your own husband, that even if some do not obey the word, they without a word may be won by the conduct of their wives." How did he know that this was to be one of the first and often repeated reasons the wives mention when we ask them about what to be submitted to their husbands? How many times did we hear the words, "I cannot submit to my husband because my husband is not submitted to the Lord"? This is not a valid reason. So the wife ought to submit to her husband, and by submitting, they may bring their spouse back to the word. The reverse is not an option. To conclude this part, when we speak of biblical submission, we speak first and foremost of submission to God first. This was a great driving force for Yeshua in his humanity. We get so great an example. And this is what Paul is bringing out in our next, in the text of Ephesians. But for this, I'm going to leave it for tomorrow, where actually we're going to speak about the role of the husband to the wife. So wives, make sure that your husbands come here tomorrow. All right, so, and vice versa. Good. So we'll keep on tomorrow and we'll see what is the role of the husband, because I want to tell you that the Bible speaks more about the role of the husband than that of the wife. And it is very important. It is part of having a healthy congregation.